I pray thee, once again. I wonder if it's surrounded by ones of such talent. You know? Speak like, live a humble and meek life. Ordinary day of the week life. Try to search and seek life. Way up. Keep your head up and stay up. Even when you're sore and pain up. Never giving up till it's game up. Keep your aim up and focus. Don't concentrate on what's bogus. Never sell out for a bonus. Handle your biz like grown-ups. Own up, it's amazing. The wage of fire keeps blazing. That's why you're constantly praising. For some of them it's a phase thing. So they're gazing on the street lights. Till them go catch up in street fights. Cause they're pretending they're street wise. And put an end to a brief life. I feel like it's a mystery. We keep repeating our history, making the same mistakes as our ancestors. Seems like all of life lessons missed with. It's risky, so give praises. One day you may find your oasis. Rise up to the challenge you're faced with. Much time has been wasted, man, building military bases, fighting a war with no basis. Life is sacred, and every baby born naked.
That you know what you want and still on the same page, but here we are chasing hope in the hope we stay honest. Sometimes life can kick you when you're down, but we got that faith. Yeah, we got that stargazing in our eyes. We got that faith. Yeah, we got that willingness to try. Cause we got that.
I pray thee, once again. I wonder if it's surrounded by ones of such talent. You know? life. Live a humble and meek life. Ordinary day of the week life. Try to search and seek life. Way up. Concentrate on what's bogus. Never sell out for a bonus. Handle your biz like grown-ups. Own up. It's amazing. The wage of fire keeps blazing. That's why you're constantly praising. For some of them it's a face thing, so they're gazing on the street lights. Till them go catch up in street fights. Cause they're pretending they're street wise. And put an end to a brief life. I feel like it's a mystery. Our history, making the same mistakes as our ancestry. Seems like all of life lessons missed with. It's risky, so give praises. One day you may find your oasis. Rise up to the challenge you're faced with. Too much time has been wasted, man, building military bases, fighting a war with no basis. Life is sacred, and every baby born naked.
See, I know that you know what you're wanting. Still on the same page, but here we are. Chasing hope in the hope we stay honest. Sometimes life can kick you when you're down. But we got that faith. Yeah. We got that stargazing in our eyes. We got that faith. Yeah, we got that.
I pray thee once again. I wonder if it's surrounded by ones of such talent. Thank you.
Heaven, it's so peaceful, it's so free, like you prayed. It is warm, it's so bright and so beautiful. All my fear and my pain have gone away, 'cause here in heaven, oh, I miss you so. But I know we'll meet someday. But now please go and spread your wings and seize the day. I'm okay, 'cause I'm dancing in the sky. Each day I'm singing in the angels' choir. I hope that you go and live your life. Never give up, one day we will unite. The sun shines so bright in heaven. I'm at peace, I'm happy, and I'm free. And someday we'll walk these clouds together. But first you must go and see the world for me. 'Cause here in heaven, oh, I miss you so. But I know we'll meet someday. But now please go and spread your wings and seize the day. I'm okay, 'cause I'm dancing in the sky. Each day I'm singing in the angels' choir. I hope you go and you live your life. Never give up, one day we'll unite. We'll reunite.
Thank you, Commander McFarlane. On behalf of the family of Brady, we welcome you this morning to this gorgeous setting, absolutely beautiful, for this opportunity to remember the life of Richard Brady Pitcher, a wonderful gift from God, who left us 2 years ago. Just want to pause to say a happy Mother's Day to all mothers here especially to you, Eileen. Time seems to pass so quickly, but the memories are as fresh as ever. The brevity of Brady's physical time with us just seems to highlight how unique, wonderful, and fascinating a person he was. We wish that this time together will be a celebration of his life and a time of thanksgiving that we were afforded the opportunity to be acquainted with and privileged to share such wonderful moments. This was indeed a gift from God. Let's bow our heads this morning in prayer. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we acknowledge your greatness, wisdom, and might. We also confess the mystery of your actions from our human perspective that puzzle us. But who are we to challenge you when we have to confess the limitations of our humanity and the sinfulness of our lives? So we approach you dependent on your mercy and grace. Although we may not understand all that happens to us or around us, we choose to trust your love for us. This love was demonstrated to us when you sent your son Jesus to suffer and die on our behalf in order to make us acceptable to God. Life and death may be a mystery to us, but we look to Jesus who became like us in order to triumph over death and the grave and declare his victory. We therefore choose to live in the victory of his resurrected life. So, Father, our special request today is to provide your strength and comfort to the family and friends of Brady who gather here today. May we be able to have your perspective and be able to have a joy that conquers sorrow, so we will be able to celebrate. Bless these proceedings for your honor and glory. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Our family wishes to express our deepest appreciation for all the ongoing prayers, love, kindness, and support during this very difficult season of life. Our lives are forever changed, but Brady's light continues to shine on, in and through us. This love leads each of us to find our new ways of walking with ease in this world without Brady's physical presence. We are grateful for each of you taking time out of your morning to be with us to celebrate our beloved Brady's life and new beginning in God's care. Thanks to Fern Proctor for the beautiful program and to Coffee Traders Limited and the Sharp family for providing the coffee bar and sweet treats. Thank you to our dear friend, Reverend Michael Smiley, for being with us today and officiating. Thank you to Lieutenant Commander John McFarlane, Paulette Bellamy, and Alex Martin Blanken for being here to provide the beautiful music. Thank you to Dennis Duncan for providing the technology and live streaming, which allows our family and friends who are not able to be here in person to share with us. A special thank you and love to Stansfield and Tony. We are truly grateful in ways that cannot be fully expressed in words. From our family to yours, our deepest gratitude for providing the strength we needed at our darkest hours.
Good morning, everybody, and happy Mother's Day again, especially to you, Eileen, and to my dear wife. I have to say that as well. You know, I had the privilege yesterday of going to somewhere where Brady loved very much, and it filled me with a lot of emotion, but I was so glad to have got a chance to go to that private place where he loved so much. And I felt his energy and his love, and I think he was with us all day yesterday. And I thought he was carrying me some luck, so much to the point that I thought I'd bet my first race on the Kentucky Derby. And I picked a real, I didn't pick the winner which and everything, but I had a great time, and it was a great day. And it made me feel, it got rid of a lot of feelings that I had bottled up for the past 2 years. Indeed, it was a privilege. And it was a privilege, when I look back on the pictures on the program, Eileen, to, I can't even remember that picture, to have been the godfather along with Karen, who's the godmother, be there that special day with you both. From when he was born, I felt a connection with Brady that I can't describe to today. I'm still trying to figure it out. And he had so much energy. I think I'm getting it right. Remember when at the house on, is it Cranberry? My goodness, that boy could run up and down in that house. I've never seen energy like that in my life. And I said, he's going to really, you know, make a mark in this world. And he did, and everything that he endeavored, his energy went into, it was very synonymous with his efforts, and whether it was diving, playing drums, you know, even his academics, which I think academics were boring to him, you know, the traditional institutions, etc. He was above that, but he made every effort, and he put all the energy he could into making himself and his family happy for him and a success in his life. He was a confident person and a motivating person, and he loved to lead. You could always see David and Drew in his tow, you know, in everything they did. They really enjoyed each other's company. I was just so happy to be part of that period of his life in that early part and see how he matured, and it continued into his business opportunities and everything right to the end. He was a team leader. He loved what he did, and if he didn't love it, he got out of it and moved on to something else, and that was so encouraging for me to see. And in a way, he reminded me a lot of myself growing up, and his demeanor and his carefree attitude to life, and I loved him for that. I really miss him, because I think we spoke a lot. Every time, you know, it was his birthday or my birthday, there was that effort on both of our parts. He was always busy in the last couple of years, but he always made time to speak to me at length. And whenever he came to Jamaica, Eileen, you know, he always made an effort to come and visit. And he had impeccable manners. I know, you know, everybody may see a different part of Brady, but when it came to us, he had incredible manners and respect for our family. And I'll never forget the time when Ian's parents came down for that Christmas and they came over to our house for Christmas, and that it was such a wonderful, beautiful day. And there are little things that make me remember so much about Brady's presence in my life. And I miss him dearly. But I'm connected still to him through the memories we shared, and of course to the family. And I truly honor those feelings. So I won't spend too long. My wife has warned me not to ramble on. And I just want to say again, thanks for being part of this family. I was endorsed yesterday into the family, in my hand, and I respect that. And I love everybody in the family, and we'll stay close, James, as you have said. God bless you, Brady, and may your memories live on amongst us. Thank you.
Morning, everyone. So, okay, let me get in the right place. So in trying to do this tribute, it's been 2 years in the making, and every time I tried, no words came. And it was only when I wrote to Brady that the words actually came on paper. And so I'm going to read a very small, small synopsis of my love letter. And bear with me with the emotions. Dear Brady boy, not in my wildest dreams did I ever fathom I would be standing here under these circumstances, but here I am. The Bible says Jesus died on a Friday, his people mourned on Saturday, and rejoiced on the Sunday. You, my Brady, were given to us on Wednesday, October 25th, 1995. You were taken from us on Friday, May 8th, 2020. So today's is 2 year anniversary, angelversary. I will rejoice when my Sunday comes. Until then, every day for me will be Saturday. God giveth and God taketh. Who am I to question? I know God leans in close to the brokenhearted, and so I also lean in and trust that in time I will have the peace and courage I need to run the rest of this race in a way that will make you proud. Brady, we were blessed beyond measure the day you were born. You were then and will always be our bright light. In true Brady form, you entered this world bursting with life and energy. Your energy has always been so palpable. Fear has never been a part of your makeup or part of your vocabulary. You are always willing to try new and adventurous things, to step outside the box and stretch the boundaries. You moved to the beat of your own drum, and you made no apologies for it. This is what makes you so special. We always joked saying this is Brady's world and we're just living in it. You forged your own path and journeyed bravely with that ever indomitable, infrangible spirit. From a tender age, I remember you climbing the grill gates at home with no fear of falling. I guess in your mind, you believed your daddy and I would always be there to protect you. Oh, how I wish that were an absolute truth. Then there was the 5 a.m. wake-up calls every morning to get your milk and then go dig and chop out in the yard. You had a never-ending amount of energy. We were grateful when you were able to get your own milk from the fridge, giving us an extra few minutes before we had to get up and go dig and chop. At night, we had to get you into idle mode, as you seemed to think if you fell asleep, you would miss out. As you got older, you continued to explore the world with high energy and gusto. There are so many epic moments that make me smile when I think about them, even the ones that got you into trouble, and there were a lot of those. Do you remember all those food quirks? Brady would say, "It's all about the texture, Mom, not the taste." When you graduated from baby food, you instantly gave up fruits and vegetables, unless I made a smoothie, and it better be smooth with no grit. I had to blend the vegetables and hide them in the meat sauce, and I bet you never knew that, Brady boy. As for bananas, I can only describe it as a banana phobia. You would not touch them or even sit beside someone who was eating one. Maybe I just ate too many bananas when I was pregnant, who knows? If you could, you would live off of pizza, patty, pasta, and peanut butter. From day one, you were a huggy, touchy-feely child, always wanting a lift up, a back scratch before bed, or just to lie in my lap or on my shoulder, watching TV as I rubbed your head or combed your curly locks. As you got older, some of these rituals never changed, and with them, the tables got turned. You started lifting me when I could no longer lift you. Do you remember when you would use the bathroom, wash your hands, and then try to dry them on our faces, saying, "Pee-pee in the bathroom"? Man, I think that drove all of us nuts in a funny kind of way. You always seem to have tricks up your sleeve. And then, whenever we would go walking when you were older, you would always throw your heavy arm over my shoulder. I would smile inside and hold your hand. I missed your heavy arm and all the huggy, touchy-feely moments. You always had big plans and big dreams. In the 24 and a half years that you were allotted, you certainly packed it in conventionally and unconventionally. I'm at peace with the fact that we allowed you to walk your path your way, even when it did not fit in to the traditional mold. Underneath that tough outer shell, you truly had a tender heart, especially for family, dogs, and for those persons who were less fortunate. Remember our days at Mona Rehab feeding and reading to the children? You did it so effortlessly. I also remember you thinking little Betty, our sponsored child, should just come and live with us, and that would solve the problem. If only life were so simple. You experienced many sports along the way, but diving was definitely your passion. You loved the ocean. You became a certified dive master as a teen. Of course, I was terrified, and you had zero fear. It was pure joy, excitement, and adventure for you. It was indeed wonderful to see you on the other side of the glass aquarium and seeing pictures of you mingling with the sharks. I always admired your appreciation and love for music, even when I didn't like the music. That crossed over many a generation and genre, from Mozart and Frank Sinatra to Drake and Junior Gong. There was no judgment or boundaries, which I saw spill over into the way you lived and experienced life. You eventually launched out on your own and started your own business, helping a few youngsters to find a path that would afford them a better life. Some of the stories they have shared warm my heart. I truly believe you are finding your way and destined to great things. God obviously had greater plans. Your thirst for knowledge, along with your gift of gab, was truly amazing and a force to be reckoned with, sometimes driving me around the bend, especially when we had a difference of opinion or when you wanted something and I was not giving in. You were relentless in getting your point across or trying to have your own way. As a child, you were always ready for talk time, especially at bedtime. I think that was a ploy to stay awake just a little bit longer. I remember the night during Hurricane Francis in Bermuda, as we played Catch the Shadows with flashlights, you all of a sudden, seemingly out of the blue, wanted to know where babies came from. Yikes. I was totally taken off guard. As we had dogs, you kind of understood how dogs mated and puppies were the result. So in my moment of brilliance, I decided to use that as my point of reference. Well, your face got all screwed up and you said, "Ooh, gross, mummy. You did that 2 times? I burst into laughter and said, "No, actually 3 times, with a smile on my face. Well, now you know, Brady boy, that's not the case, and also not so gross after all. As you got older, talk time changed, but the talking never stopped. When you moved out on your own, Wednesdays became our text day, and Sundays our talk time, always ending with love you lots. We have shared countless moments of joy, laughter, tears, and numerous discussions about girls, relationships, religion, meditation, who says what is good or bad, and what comes after this life, just to name a few. All these moments are embedded within my heart and soul. One of the greatest gifts you have given me is encouraging and teaching me the importance of meditation in one's life. I know for sure it has enhanced my faith journey, and I would not be able to stand here today if it were not for my daily meditations. I still talk to you every day, and I know you don't find that so strange or surprising. You have taught me so much, and you continue to teach me, even in your physical absence. 24 and a half years is a very short time to have shared this life with us. God clearly had other plans, and as hard and as painful as it is, I must surrender and come to a place of acceptance. You fulfilled your purpose here, and it was time to move on to greater things. It was indeed short, but it was a full life. Mrs. Mullings from Mona Prep always said, "You are like an old man in a little boy's body." I know that family is very important and everything to you. And you, Brady boy, are everything to us. Thank you for being you. Thank you for your 24 and a half years. And thank you for the last 6 weeks that you spent with us. As much as COVID has wreaked havoc, it is what brought you home in March of 2020. And for that, I am truly grateful. Who says what is good or bad? There was the cooking competitions, the card games, badminton, the heated debates, the laughter, and still the combing of your beautiful curls. The day you guys were heading off to Texas, we unknowingly gave each other our last hug, our last kiss, our last face-to-face, "I love you," and I sent you on your merry way. We are blessed to have been given those precious moments. Brady, just in case you need a gentle reminder, which I know you don't, so just humor me. You are my north, south, east, and west. You are my sunshine and my rain. You are my morning, my midnight, and every minute in between. You are one of the apples of my eye. You are the wind beneath my wings. You are one of my heartstrings binding us into eternity. So even though my heart is shattered, the strings are still connected and bound nice and tight. Your bright light will forever shine on, in, and through me. You will continue to walk with me, just in a different way. Your presence is still palpable, and so I know you are just a thread string away. Thank you for the special feathers. I appreciate the red cardinals that come to visit outside our house, and I hear you whistle in the kitchen every so often. I am blessed and honored that I was chosen to be your mummy. The joys, the challenges, the laughter, and the pain that comes with this charge and responsibility has made me who I am today, and for that I am eternally grateful. I cannot promise that I will always be strong. When I cry, remember I am crying with love, and I will continue to put one foot in front of the other, as you would expect nothing less. There are many unanswered questions, and yet I hear you in the stillness. Mom, things are never quite as they seem, so question not, worry not, and know that all is well with my soul. Brady boy, I will never forget you. I will never move on. I will never be okay that you're gone. But your spirit, your heart, your laugh runs through me like I'm living for you. You are part of my DNA. And now everything I touch, all that I accomplish, I do it with you in mind for all of the life that never came to you. You loved Pooh Bear as a child. And so I say to you, a day without you is like Pooh having a pot with not a single drop of honey left inside. I love you, my Brady boy, beyond the measure of space and time. I release you into God's care until my Sunday comes and our souls reunite and rejoice again. Walk good, my beloved son, and remember to save a place for me. To everyone here today, sorry. Life is but a fleeting moment, and we are not promised tomorrow. Do not waste your time living in the past, or spend time worrying about the future, which may never come to be. But concentrate the mind on the precious present moments of today. Speak your truth. Don't hold grudges. Live and love fully, so that when your day comes, there are no regrets. All right, I'm almost done. It would be remiss of me not to wish all the mummies here Happy Mother's Day. It is my hope that this morning will not be a damper, but be a gentle spark of light that reminds us all that our children are gifts that are not of us, but through us. Love them well. Allow them to be who they are meant to be, not who you want them to be. Show them through your actions, not your words only, that they always have a safe space under our wings. Our children are God's precious gift, which allows us in a very minute way the privilege of tasting unconditional love on earth. There is no greater gift that we could ever ask.
Thank you.
certain. Maybe you're still here. I feel for you around me. Your memory is so clear. Deep in the stillness, I can hear you speak. You're still an inspiration. Can it be that you are my forever love, and you are washing over me from above?
Morning, welcome everybody. Boy, I tell you, 2 years seems like a long time, but it really isn't, because all the emotions come back again. So I'm not sure if I'll be able to do as well as my wife, because she's also my strength. I'm going to tell a couple of stories, because that's the only way I'm going to get through this. And as you can see, I didn't bring a paper like my wife, because about 23 years ago, I was given the privilege of speaking at one of my great friends' wedding down at Rio Chico, Jason and Jackie. And I prepared and studied. And the first words that came out of my mouth was, Christopher Columbus came to this place many, many years ago. and he landed in Jamaica. And I did not emphasize my H's. And I said, never again will I prepare in that way to give a speech. I'm just going to talk from the heart. Right before we got married, Eileen said to me, you know what? It's a package deal. I said, you don't have any children, but I have two. And I said, okay. I've been around this earth for 49 years. I know how to handle this stuff. Why was I in for a surprise? So, in the summer of 2008, because Olympics was going on, or nine, I said, Eileen, I want to bring you and the children up to California. I was living in California at the time. And we can just have a fun, you know, see what it is to be a stepdad before we actually became a stepdad. Like a prize, it's like a dress rehearsal, right? So I said, you know what, let's invite your mama as well, hoping that she wouldn't come, you know, because you're trying to be the nice brother-in-law to be, right? I mean, son-in-law, you know, she won't come. You don't know mamas. She was present. I was like, great. So now I had a four-bedroom house in California, so I had to go buy a bed because she's coming. So anyway, I went and bought me a twin bed and put it downstairs. Eileen and Mamas had my bedroom and kids had share another bedroom. So we're going to Disney. Is it World or Disneyland? Disneyland in California? Sorry, John, Disneyland. So I said, I'm going to impress these children. All day we're down in San Diego and all over the places, and we're eating, and finally driving back to Riverside where I lived, and we made one more stop to eat. And Brady, for the 18th time that day, was eating. And so we got home. And so, no, actually Brady and Drew were sleeping in my bed. And Mama's son and Eileen were in the other guest room, and I was downstairs. So I get up the next morning about 6:30, and I walk into the kitchen and I see legs all over the couch. I'm like, what's going on? Brady boy had way too much to eat. Threw up all over my bed, my comforter, my sheets. And she says, are you sure you want to go through with this thing? So I know that's when I knew that this guy walked to a different tune, right? My second story I'm going to tell is, so we get married, living in Atlanta. Brady's living with us downstairs. And now we have a room downstairs that's kind of isolated, way in the back. Has a little window in the back there. So Eileen is in Jamaica, because Eileen really took care of my dad at the time, was very ill. And she's getting a break, and we had my brother-in-law's mother-in-law come up from Florida to help out. And I'm playing golf, because many of you know that's my passion, right? I'm out at the golf course all day. I get a phone call from Grandma Lynette. She says, Philip, Brie, there's a girl in the room downstairs. So I says, all right, I'm on my way. So 45 minutes, I arrive. I said, Brady, you know the rules, man. He says, Uncle Philip, I mean, what is wrong? What do you used to do when you were young? I said, that's what I know what I'm talking about. So he says, okay, Uncle Philip. I said, open the door, man. He said, Uncle Philip, she's not here. I said, open the door. I see her bag. I said, well, whose bag is that? All right, she's in the closet. I said, call her Uber right now. Right now, take her out of here. So he calls the Uber. He says, I'm going to walk with her down the street, make sure she gets on okay. 30 minutes later, I walk downstairs. I said, Brady, I know the first day I met you, you were 15, but you sound like you were always acting like you were 25. Where's the girl? She says, Uncle Philip, I put her in an Uber. I said, Brady, come on, man. You think I was born last night? Well, Brady had let the Uber stop down the road, brought her back, opened the window in the back, let her back in. And, you know, I'm trying to be the decent stepdad, right? And you just, you know, I've never done this thing. I said, I don't understand you, Brady. These are not things that you do at this age. So that's my second story. My second to last story, because I have some time. My wife told me I had 5 minutes. I'm taking it all. In 2000, right after we got married. So we got married in 2011. Is that right, babe? And so Brady comes to live with us in 2012. He had left Ridley and come to live with us. And he always was reading. Brady was very well read, extremely well read. Brady used to tell me about things I did in my plant that he said I should be doing, because he knew it. He knew it all, if he knew Brady. And he said, Uncle Philip, there's this thing called Bitcoin, and I think you need to buy some. I said, all right, make me a proposal. He says, I tell you what, let's buy 20 Bitcoins. I said, how much is that going to cost me? He said, about $1,500. And so what do I get out of it? He says, well, when it goes up, you can sell it and make a lot of money, and you can give me some of it. I said, Bray, I don't know anything about Bitcoin, you know. I know about stocks. So I said, go and research some stocks and come back, and we'll do that together. And he did. He went and researched some stock and came back, and we had $1,000. And I says, all right. And we wrote a contract, right, that when he sells, he gets his portion, I get mine. Because I have to pay taxes, because it's in my name. So I said, you pick out the stocks you want to buy. And he did. Because Brady always was looking a way to make some money. Always. That's what I loved about him. He's entrepreneurial. And at the end, that's what he was doing. He had 3 or 4 businesses. Trust me, Eileen has spent 2 years trying to close them down. Because you have to in the States once somebody passes away. And so he says, Uncle Philip, I think you're making a mistake. I said, Brady, you're 15 years old. What do you know about investing? Well, folks, I tell you something. Those 20 Bitcoins at their top were worth $1.2 million. Okay? Today, I mean, it's down to about 38,000 now. And I say, you know, Brady boy, if I just listened to you, we'd have owned some apartment buildings together. We'd have been living life, because we had a bet also that he said that when he became a billionaire, I would get 10 million. And I made that deal. Because I can't lose on that deal. But that's just Brady. But as I end talking about that guy who just went to a, just lived to a different beat. Just lived to a different beat. While I was dating Eileen, you know, living in America for all these years, I used to call everybody buddy. Right? And so every day I'd say, hey, buddy, how you doing? Hey, Brady. Hey, Brady, my buddy. So after about 2 months of this, he goes to his mother. And he says, Mommy, I don't like when Uncle Philip call me buddy. No, I'm not thinking about anything what you all are thinking, right? I'm just saying this is just, you know, so an entire term of endearment. So Eileen says, Brady, it's really, he lives in America for a long time, and that's what they call each other. He says, well, I really don't like the term buddy. Ladies and gentlemen, today I miss my buddy. And I'll do anything to reach out to him. And says, hey, buddy. So I leave you with those stories, because as a man who knows nothing about raising children, and you say you learn when you get into a family, I used to always say, why do you treat the children like the folks at the plant? And I said, honey, I don't know any better. I really don't. But Brady taught me a lot. Tolerance, love. I mean, I'd get upset with Brady, and 10 minutes later, he's coming and hugging me up. I was like, what are you doing? He says, we just had, Uncle Phil, I don't know what we're arguing about again. That's how Brady was. Just forget it and move on. And I just, it's a sad day. It's a celebration of life. And he talks to us in unique ways every single day. But honey, Ian, Drew, I miss my buddy. Thank you all.
I need my speech. I don't have the talent of Raymond and Philip. Richard Brady Pitcher. Stand in the sunlight. Walk through life. Love all the things that make you strong. Be anything, tasting the sunshine of life. Amiri Baraka's words bring with them for me an image of Brady. He went after the sunshine of life with such absolute passion and purpose that those who gathered around him were just mesmerized by his vitality. And his ardent accounts of all that he'd discovered and all that he was on a continuous quest, thanks, to uncover. And then, like a comet blazing across the evening sky, he would be off once again in pursuit of yet another magnificent experience. And for those of us who tried to keep pace with what he might be up to next, we soon learned that this would be a very ambitious task. So instead, we who were fortunate to have been part of his family and his extended family were happy to simply sit back, listen to his anecdotes, and bask in his aura for the moments he was near. We enjoyed every bit of his sunshine, and we still bask in it now, because we feel his presence in so many unexpected ways, and always will. My godson Brady was born 3 months ahead of my firstborn, Nina. Having little prior experience with babies, I thought, let me catch my practice, as they say, with Brady. Well, I soon realized that I was in no way prepared for what it seemed was to come. First of all, this baby boy was chock full of non-stop energy. His voice, his was a voice like fireworks at a festival. He had spunk, stamina, you name it. He was always on the move, and he never slept. I don't think Eileen and Ian did either. In my already exhausted pregnant state, I became suddenly super anxious about what I had gotten myself into with this upcoming parenting thing. But then came Nina, quiet and calm, curious and observant, low-key and mellow. So we knew then for sure Brady was in a league of his own. He lived life out loud. And we loved that about him. A live wire who connected intensely with others, laughed heartily, and loved profoundly. He did eventually become versed in how to slow down and recharge his batteries. In his adulthood, he learned the art of meditation, and could skillfully block out the noise of the turning world whenever he needed to be still. There are people who dream of adventures without ever actually venturing off the beaten path. Brady was not one of those people. He ventured far and wide with little, if any, hesitation. Tristan, my middle son, described him as a practical and fearless thinker who loved history and culture. As a young boy, he remembers being encouraged by Brady, who was only about 2 years older than he was. One day after school, when he became utterly frustrated with history classes, "Tristan, history helps us understand who we are," Brady insisted, and went on to talk all about how history helps shape our political beliefs. He reassured him of the urgent need to stay the course. Needless to say, Tristan did indeed stay the course, and both history and foreign cultures became significant aspects of his major. Nicholas, my youngest, remembers that brilliant and unforgettable moment many years ago when, after returning home from a music lesson, Brady took hold of his drumstick, sat down on the stool, and taught him the single-hand drum roll on his trap set. This new and very cool skill reignited such a spark of excitement in Nicholas, whose interest in the instrument had begun to fade, that he went back to class with renewed enthusiasm and performed on stage as a drummer for some years afterwards. He also remembers, well, or now confesses, the thrill of being introduced by Brady to what he knew to be non-age appropriate shows on the internet when the adults were out of sight. Yep, that was Brady too. His spontaneous exhilaration for life itself inspired others in so many ways and drew them to him. He certainly had a knack for making genuine and meaningful connections with all people, regardless of age, educational level, status, beliefs, background, religion, race. He could find common ground with them all. Well, even as he debated whatever topic of interest was being discussed. What a beautiful difference a single life can make. Brady has made a lasting impact on every one of us in his own special way. We are, each of us, left completely shattered by his physical departure. But knowing Brady, he would not want us to be mournful and wishing for more of him, nor for what cannot be. Instead, he would want us to simply be anything. And if I were to question why he left us way too soon, I can only just imagine him arguing back in his usual sparring fashion. "But, Auntie Karen, life, if well lived, is long enough." Brady's light lit up our lives. His was truly a life well lived.
There's a lot that I wrote to say about Brady, a whole speech, and the entire time writing the speech, I could hear Brady saying to me, "What you need that for?" Brady, I would say, was the most influential person in my life when it comes to me having a voice, when it comes to me speaking publicly and privately, communicating my feelings, and addressing people. I used to be, you know, very shy. I think most people growing up with me know that. I think even I see Emma, Sarah, Uncle Raymond, and Mrs. Miles. I'm so sorry. I don't know why I can't get your name right now, but Eva, yes, Auntie Eva, yes. Thank you. I don't know. Yeah, Brady and Drew used to take me to their house many times, and I would just be there. Don't really know what to say, don't really know what to do. And it was always Brady who encouraged me to interact, and I think one time, I don't know exactly what happened because Brady never told me, but you know, I think Luke had said something about me being annoying, being there, which is fine, whatever, you know. But Brady was pissed. And, you know, there were so many times that Brady had stood up for me without me asking, without me even knowing there was a reason for him to stand up for me. And that kind of force in my life, you know, has made me think very much about the kind of legacy I want to leave. Because Brady has certainly left a legacy for all of us to follow. Now I'll look back to my speech because there's a point that I want to make now. All right, Brady always said, you don't need a speech. And I said, how am I going to remember everything I want to say? He said, you have the talent to do it naturally, but you can make a few bullet points if you want. Brady was a very protective, kind, and true person. For many people, including me, the way we're perceived is based on how we present ourselves to other people. But I think everyone here who knows Brady would always agree on the same type of person he is, because he was the same person to everyone he was with. Brady was a relentless debater, a dedicated mentor, a fierce protector, and absolutely a forward thinker. When Brady believed something was right or wrong, he made sure you knew it. Didn't matter what you thought, he would argue with you and come to an understanding or tire you out. It was one of those options. Many times I've witnessed it with Auntie Eileen, with Daniil, with my mom, with my dad, with Mamas, with Uncle Ian, with Drew, with me. And, you know, it's something we miss very much, because Brady also forced us to have conversations that would not always happen. Brady would talk religion, Brady would talk end of life, Brady would talk finances, Brady would talk everything. And it's these memories that inspire me to try to live up to his legacy and try to bring these conversations back and this kind of life, and, you know, keep his kind of life in our lives. I really wish I could do this speech impromptu in true Brady fashion. But he was a master of his craft. Brady was able to talk and structure his thoughts, you know, very, very efficiently and very easy to understand. It's a skill that I hope to hone as well as he did. As a mentor, Brady has taught me many things about women, many things about men, many things about what it means to be a man, what it means to achieve success, what it means to do what is right, and what it means to define for yourself what is right. Because ultimately, he taught me that you live your life and you make your choices, and no one else can do that for you. No matter what people say about the law, the government, stocks and shares, Bitcoin and crypto. Every decision you make is your decision to make. And every decision you make is one that you must own up to. And one of the most valuable things I learned from him can be condensed into a single phrase. It's given me confidence. it's given me, what's the word? Accountability. The ability to hold myself accountable. And it's this phrase: what you have to say has value simply because you chose to say it. What you say has power simply because you give it that power. And one demonstration of that, I think, was one of my most fondest memories of Brady. It's a very funny memory. We went to this summer school at UTEC, was it? It was UTEC. And Bounty Killer's son was also there. And he thought that he could make some smart comments to Drew. And, they're very disrespectful comments. And personally, I think the reaction was warranted, which was for Brady to take off Bounty Killer's son's shoes and beat him with his own shoes. Inspiring, really. Truly inspiring. It's hard to conclude because I don't think any of us were prepared to conclude or prepared for any of this, really. But there are so many times where Brady has done things for me without me asking, stood up for me without me asking, spoken on my behalf without me asking, made arguments for me, gotten me to go places, gotten me to go out when normally I don't think I would have been able to go out. He's been my friend in times where I had no friends. Not to say I didn't have any friends, I'm a pretty funny guy. But I mean, I was lonely, I wasn't doing anything. Brady saw that. Brady said, come, let's play some Mario Kart, let's do something. Let's go out, let's go meet some people. And so I have to say thank you, Brady, so much for everything you've done for me, for everything you've managed to give me, for the skills you've given me to get things for myself. Because I never got to say thank you. It went without saying, but it would still have been nice to say. I miss you, Brady. I love you, Brady. And I hope wherever you are, whatever it is you're doing now, I know it's powerful and I can feel their effects today. Thank you for the 23, I guess, because I only got 21 years with him, but thank you for those years. I will cherish them for the rest of my life. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm not officially on the program, but I spoke to Eileen this morning and told her that I wasn't able to sleep last night. I felt like I was communing with Brady's spirit all night. And I wanted to share a very short experience that I had with him. I had only 8 years with Brady. I met him when he was 16. I'd like to start with a quote from Socrates. This sense of wonder is the mark of the philosopher. Philosophy indeed has no other origin. I met Brady because my cousin, Dr. Suzanne Law, knew him and felt that we would be a good match spiritually, philosophically. She knew that I had lived a life being very, very enthusiastic and disciplined in the lifestyle of mindfulness meditation. So I met Brady at Devon House. And in our first meeting, I quickly just shared my perspective of life and of the lifestyle of mindfulness and meditation. I didn't know what to expect. I had no idea how he was going to respond. I was hit by a presence of openness of mind, openness of heart, a sense of enthusiasm, and a sense of wonder to pursue a lifestyle that could give him the attainment of sublime knowing, spiritually and philosophically. His presence hit me hard when he said to me with a kind of presence in his voice tone, in the tone of his voice, "Sir, can I be your student?" My body was overcome with goosebumps, and I knew that I had a worthy student, a prodigy, a psycho-spiritual and philosophical prodigy. I didn't have to teach him much. I didn't have to teach him for very long. His enthusiasm, his overzealousness, just was remarkable. He put me on the razor's edge. He was difficult to control. He always wanted to put his mind in places where I felt he should take some time just developing the foundations. No. He understood. He knew it. I quickly realized that teaching Brady was just not really teaching him. It was just every now and then give him a course correction. He had a momentum. He had a destiny with wisdom. There's a verse of scripture that I remember right now that comes from the Liberal Catholic Mass. "Blessed are those that seek the wisdom of the Lord early, for they shall be filled with joy." We're all going to have waves of grief when we think of Brady. Let us embrace that as evidence of his existence. Let us embrace that with love and know that the essence of that is love. And in that kind of meditation and our grief and our love for Brady, let us all be mindful of the fact that right now, his soul, his spirit, his mind stream is a joy-filled philosopher pursuing sublime knowing in heavenly realms. Thank you.
Flies, just hold on and try the ride. 1 minute just sneaking out your mom shot, we go a party. The next minute singing lullabies, like hold on there. Long days and fast nights, wrong turns and stoplights. Life is a journey, remember me tell you, you're blessed here by life, cause you only get one life. So don't waste it, don't be basic. If you have a dream, you better chase it. If something wrong, replace it. In a life you learn, when you fall, you're always strong enough to face it. No life rough when nobody really knows what you've been through. Just hold on firm when nobody say you always got to. And I know you've heard this all before. I never me tell you now. But I know no back in the day I really wish I knew.
Just embrace it all. Just embrace it all. Just embrace just embrace it all. For your life, try to get it right. Yeah, yeah. Just embrace it all. Just embrace it all. Just embrace it all. For your life, try to get it right. Yeah, yeah. All the qualities, the policies, and yours for you, obviously. A Hennessy with the apple juice, reflecting on my journey and how I never had a backup route. Everything was absolute, I did what I had to do. A lot of people losing to themselves, and that's a tragic truth. Shit, I was 17 just a blink ago. I was 21 just a drink ago. Think and grow rich on my dresser. The journey's my professor. Buried in your mind is the treasure. Yes, sir.
Life's short and time flies. Just hold on and try the ride. 1 minute just sneaking out your mom's yard, we go a party. The next minute singing lullabies, like Holland. Long days and fast nights, wrong turns and stoplights. Life is a journey. Remember me tell you, you're blessed, you're alive, 'cause you only get one life. So don't waste it, don't be basic. If you have a dream, you better chase it. If something wrong, replace it. In a life you learn, when you fall, you're always strong enough to face it. I know life rough with nobody. Just hold on firm when nobody's there, you always got to. And I know you've heard this all before. I never me telling you, but I know no back in the day. I really wish I knew.
Just embrace it all. Just embrace it all. Just embrace it all. For your life, got to get it right. Yeah, yeah. Just embrace it all.
So as you can see, I decided to take a different approach to this speech because, you know, I really wanted to truly celebrate my brother. So before I start, as unconventional as it is, I would like everybody to stand up and give your best and loudest standing ovation for Brady. Okay, now hold on to that good vibes. Because that's the kind of energy Brady held in this world and continues to hold in spirit. Chief Seattle once said, "There's no death, only a change of worlds." And I've come to realize how true that is. And well, in the moments I forget, Brady finds a way to remind me that he's still here with me. Sometimes he's subtle about it, but other times, not so much. He loved to mess with me. He loved to mess with me, and it's no different now. His favorite thing to do now is mess with my laptop or my phone. For example, I'll be listening to a really good song, like that one, and all of a sudden it stops. I look at my phone, and the app is closed completely. I open it back, and he goes back and stops it. And it continues, and he keeps going until I tell him, "Just stop the man, just allow it." That being said, growing up in the footsteps of an older brother isn't always easy. And because we are so competitive with each other, it made things very interesting, to say the least. He was always the first to do things, the first to start a business, the first to travel, the first to shower, which meant no hot water for me. But Brady doing things first also had its perks, because whatever he learned, I made sure not to do, or he would make sure I would not do, and would teach me the right way, so I could be better and do better. Any advice he could give, any way he could protect me, he did it, no questions asked. I remember one day Brady told me, "You know, sometimes I feel like the younger brother, because just as often, it's the other way around. And you're the one looking up for me." Brady and I used to joke about the fact that he knew me better than I knew myself, and I knew him better than he knew himself. So whenever we had to make a decision and we couldn't figure it out, or what to do, or we needed to hear the truth, guess who we were turning to? And that's the one thing that I loved most about my relationship with Brady. We'd lie for each other, but we'd never lie to each other. I mean, he could look at me a certain way, and I'd know exactly what he's thinking, and vice versa. When we were younger, and mom and dad may remember this, I don't know, and I don't know if David knows this, Brady and I even created our own language so that only we could understand what we were saying. How we exactly understood each other is beyond me to this day, because trust me, it was more sounds than a language. Our connection runs deep, and I realize how blessed I am to have experienced and continue to experience such a deep bond. But on a more serious note, my brother is my role model. He taught me so much. And like my mom had said, I'm going a little bit off script here before I finish, because I didn't want to spend a lot of time talking. But before we had left to go to Texas, Brady had to do a little convincing first before I decided to go with him. And he said to me, "Tell me why you don't want to go. Give me one good reason." I said, "I don't have any." And he said, "I want you to understand I'm doing this because I know your vision. And I believe in you. And I want to teach you what I know." Because our family is meant to be great, and we're meant to be legendary, and nobody would ever stop or prevent that. And he said, "This opportunity I'm giving you is so that you have the tools to make that happen. Because as much as you don't want to be a salesman, everyone is a salesman. You have to learn to talk. You have to know your business. You have to know how to deal with people at any point. And if you don't know, he did door-to-door sales, so there was no introduction. You had to make the door open for you." And that's what he taught me. He said, "Doors are going to be closed, and you have to force them open. No matter what, don't let them tell you no, because that don't exist. Anything is possible. There is no limitations in this life. And I'm beyond and forever grateful to have such an incredible role model to this day, because he still walks with me." But out of everything that he's taught me, and it's been a lot, if I had to pick one piece of advice he has given me to share with all of you that I think could help and lead a life that he truly preached in being fearless and living an abundant life, would be this. In his words, "We are all faced with challenges in life, and no matter what the challenge is, only two things can happen. You either sink or swim. Ordinary people will choose to sink, but we are not ordinary. So really, there is no choice to be made. The only option is to swim and embrace the chaos of life."
been sad, I've been lost, I've been down on autumn lonely. I've been suffering at a job in a world that tries to own me. But when I wake up every morning, there's an image of a better place. Cause the harder that you grind, then the sweeter is the story. People say I'm foolish, people say I'm blind in my faith. But if I run out of air, if I crash, I don't care. I'm gonna do it my way. I can make it through this. You can feel the world in my face. But the fear gives me life, and I swear till I die, I'm gonna do it my way. Hey, 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 hey. I'm gonna do it my way. Hey, 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 hey. I'm gonna do it my way. So put me down, criticize me with your lies and with your pain. In the darkness I don't hide, cause I got pride that gives me clarity. I still wake up in the morning with the vision of a better life. You see, the option of defeat is just not written in my story. People say I'm foolish, people say I'm blind in my faith. But if I run out of air, if I crash, I don't care. I'm gonna do it my way. I can make it through this. You can throw the world in my face. But the fear gives me life, and I swear till I die, I'm gonna do it my way. Hey, I'm gonna do it my way. Gonna do it my way. Every time they build a wall around me, I will tear it down and I say, I'ma live my dreams. Gonna live my dreams. Even when the floods rush down to drown me, I just hold my breath and pray, let me live in my dreams. Every single one of my, I ain't quit none of my dreams. People say I'm foolish, people say I'm blind in my faith. But if I run out of air, if I crash, I don't care. I'm gonna do it my way. I can make it through this. You can do the world in my face. But the fear gives me life, and I swear till I die, I'm gonna do it my way. Let me fly through the air. If I crash, I don't care. I'm gonna do it my way. Cause the fear gives me life, and I swear till I die, I'm gonna do it my way.
Thank you, Commander. Good morning, everyone. And of course, we start off with Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers. As anybody who knows Brady, the mothers are dear to him, his grandmothers, mamas, Grandma Pitcher, Mom, Auntie Andreen. I want to thank you for sharing this time with us. Today, in Brady's fashion, I want to say to you, this gathering is a lesson. You've heard many stories, beautiful stories, people sharing these stories, which almost sometimes, you know, why, they really sound amazing, you know? Was this person all of these things? He was. From the day he was born, he got a nickname, Bigger. Strangest thing you ever seen. A child born lifting his head. The sister said, he's been here before. What is he doing lifting his head? I digress. Today in this world of technology and bits and bytes of information, is a snippet that carries with us. And we see it every day, is repeated over and over and over. So in my journey of thinking of my beloved son, I started to think, how do I, in one word, encapsulate who he was, what he is, what he means to the people, his friends, his family, and people who meet him in passing. And the word I came up with, you've heard it said in a number of ways already today, is fearless. We're not talking about the bad boy thing, you know. I'm talking about fearless as a man. And I will share with you why I say fearless as a man. You see the beautiful images that his mother has displayed here today. They look like Photoshops, eh? Very professional pictures. Can you imagine a young man at 18 years old, sorry, 17 years old, decided in his journey he needed to create images, professional images, to display to his clients who Brady Pitcher is. They must be done in a manner that reflects an individual who wants to enrich a person's life, even if he is coarse when he meets you. He is there to help, because in his belief, he wants to work with you to make this world a better place. So as you see some of these images, we were able to get them enlarged. You know, a silhouette with the sun shining behind him. These were all choreographed by Brady. He bought a professional photographer. They came for 3 days to Bermuda. He had chosen the sites, the images, what he wanted to capture, what he wanted to share with the world. Fearless. Fearless, ladies and gentlemen, because what person thinks like that? You heard his mother talk about, and his stepfather talk about, his businesses, the numerous businesses he started and his partnerships. I want to share one story that we were privileged to be shared with us. Brady was in his New Orleans operations at his office, of course, as Brady said, in a 16-story building. And he had ordered food and liquor for his staff. And a young man came to make the delivery, and Brady engaged him in a conversation, 21-year-old young man. And they got in such a deep conversation, when the young man left, he forgot to run the credit card. So he came back. He came back to Brady, and Brady said, "What do you do? Where are you living? What are you doing with your life?" And the young man said to him, "Well, I'm a father. I'm living in my car, and I'm trying to find a way to earn money." He says, "No problem, man. Listen, run my card, give yourself a $15 tip, and be here tomorrow morning, 8 o'clock sharp, because you're working for me now, from now on." What person meets an individual and says, "You need a purpose. I have the avenue to give you the purpose." And that young man came the next morning and became one of Brady's key salesmen, to be able to provide for his family, to be able to stop sleeping in his car. Fearless. How many times do we meet persons in passing and we don't want to engage them because how they look, how they sound? You know, it's very difficult to be human and allow the humanity to pour out from us. But this is an individual who was that way. The other thing I want to share with you is that he was fearless to the point when it came to debating. And I will give you an example, a good example, which many of us who are sitting here would know the characters in this debate. His grandfather, John Mackay, and his grandmother, Winsome Mackay. I can't remember his exact age, but Brady had a debate, hold on to your seats now, that it was important to us to rethink the ganja industry because it is going to be the biggest thing that hits this world, and that his grandfather and his grandmother should open their minds that this is going to happen and is a necessity because it is a natural plant and it's going to make a lot of money. Now, some of you who are sitting here know John Mackay very well, and you know Winsome Mackay. He debated very eloquently to make his point. But as many of you who are sitting here, you campaignites, that is fearless to take on, right? Fearless. No malice in it. He wasn't being jokeful, he wasn't being rebellious. He was being honest, honest conversation about the reality of life and what he saw. The other thing that I can reflect and say now, that Brady always knew his purpose. You've heard stories. Brady was always in a hurry. You know why Brady was in a hurry? Because Brady knew each step he knew. And he wasn't afraid to share that. One of my proudest moments as a father, and I'm quite sure mothers will have the same feeling, is in your life as a parent, you do many things to guide your children, and you hope they get it. You know, you pray, you think about it. Brady at 21 came to me and said, "Dad, I understand now. You are the best father I could ever ask for. And everything you've been teaching me, I now understand. So thank you." I feel very privileged because I know there's many parents that don't get that. Not that we ask for it, but we get it. You know, we do this without thinking. But I think that is fearless because we as men tend not to always show our true emotions. We keep it bottled up inside. Brady was not that person. He could stand before you and express his true, deepest feelings. So there's a theme coming here of his fearlessness. And his fearlessness are on all the things that we shun from. Brady never shunned from a conversation with a person who was more mature than him. He loved it. He would sit down and have long conversations with persons much more his senior. Why? Because he knew knowledge would eliminate any fear that he had. Similarly, if you saw Brady with a baby, all of us who know him, it's a different person. He could take a child and just engage this child without words. No fear that he's going to not do the right thing, that he's not going to hold the baby right. Just without thought, just going through it. As I reflect, I just want to, for you to all know that this young man lived a full life. We, as we grow older, we sometimes don't do certain things. but Brady doesn't want anybody to be sad for him, because in his 24 and a half years, as his mother said, he did what most, no disrespect women, most men do not do in a lifetime. In a lifetime. On our last trip together, Brady looked at me and said, "Dad, I need more of your knowledge." He says, "Don't be afraid to get involved in a business in America. I'll take care of everything. I need you on this next business venture. I need you." And I trusted him. And he said, of course, he says this in the night, in the morning, he says, "Oh, did you do the things that I asked you to do?" I said, "Brady, we just spoke about it yesterday." So that was yesterday. This is today. You're not finished. Fearless, right? Fearless, because what stops us from giving? What stops us from writing that note? What stops us from taking that 1 minute to smell the sweet air of this beautiful country? Because we're running. We're fear we're going to be late. We're going to be fear of this. All right? It's anxiety, whatever you want to call it. And I'm wrapping it up to that. So today, Brady's gift to everybody is be fearless. Grab the life. Live the life. Love your life. Don't put off what you can do today until tomorrow. Because life is about living fearlessly. Thank you.
I'm here to help to bring these proceedings to a close. And somehow, although we think we could probably sit and listen to Brady's stories all day, those of you who are not sitting in the shade would appreciate the fact that when the cloud comes over, it's a relief, but in a few moments, it will disappear and it's hot. So, I would just like, in closing, that we commit ourselves to always remember the family in prayers, to hold them up, and whenever possible, give them words of encouragement. If I may just add one personal reference to Brady's stories, because I knew him from being a kid when he was in, when we were living in Bermuda, and they were there. But the last time I interacted with him was at a house we were in Havendale, and I can't remember how long ago it was. We went there on some sort of emergency, and we're in the midst of what was going on. He engaged me in a conversation around the back, and then you saw what was so natural to him, a heart of compassion, because he was thinking of how we fail to give regard and respect to those less privileged than we are, as we are. And he was very sensitive to this. And he began telling me he had just come back from Cuba, where he spent some time. So we got into a debate about this socioeconomic conditions and the economic variables you find there and the political things. And I can't remember where it went, but you know, if you know Brady, this is going to go for a while in debating it. But I just was recalling this because I was just amazed at his perspective. And so in this remembrance, we leave our hearts a bit more widened, our knowledge of him a bit more enlightened. And I would just leave you with a passage of scripture, which I just read and just without commenting on it, from Paul's letter that you are all familiar with, his letter of love in 1 Corinthians 13. And it's amazing how he meanders to a particular conclusion. He says, "Now we see things imperfectly, like puzzling reflections in a mirror, but then we will see everything with perfect clarity. All that I know now is partial and incomplete, but then I will know everything completely, just as God knows me completely. Three things will last forever: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love." So the only thing I'll say about this, regardless of what happened, keep believing, have the faith, keep believing that what we don't understand now, we will understand perfectly then. Keep hoping so you'll never give up or never give in, but you'll be pursuing the perfection to come. Keep loving, which means keep doing good, and keep caring, even if you're hurting, keep helping. And so, as we go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace today and always, as we commit to his care this family for now and for the future. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We'll now pass over to Commander McFarlane, who will sing as they prepare to release the doves.
Life is a circle. It goes round and round. Mine's not a circus, and I'm not your clown. Always with us now.
It's always with me.
God bless each and every one of us. It's always with us now. Life is a circle. It goes round and round. A circus, and I'm not your clown. Some people with us, somewhere they're from. Still, I know my purpose is to share what we found. Some people insist to wear others down, but all will bear witness a
wonder who wears the crown.
So friends and family, again, thank you for being here with us this morning. This concludes our celebration of life. On behalf of everyone, the whole family, we invite you to have a coffee, to wake up, and go in peace, love, walk good. Thank you.
music. Another one, another one, another one.
On my own way, 'cause these days I ain't trying to complicate things. My heart's in the right place, setting my intentions, manifesting good change. Life gets hard, but a purpose, it's gotta make the bad days worth the tears. So I'll just be still, be still.
Things are happening that I can't see, and if I got patience, then I
I don't know if I can.
I don't think you're surprised.